Welcome to the Leading Edge Podcast with Eric Thompson.
Inspire, perform, profit.
Well, hey there, what's happening, everybody? It's your good friend Eric. This is the Leading Edge Podcast. Because this is episode number 20, we are going to talk about a book. So every 10th podcast, at least, I'm going to share some lessons from a book. You guys know that I'm a big reader. I love to read. Big part of my day. It's been a big part of my life, big part of my self-development. And so at least every 10th episode, I'm going to talk about a book. So consider this a book report. Today, we're going to talk about a book called Courage. I don't think it ever got to be super popular, although I wish it would have. Hopefully, you've read it. If you have not, please go out and get it, and I think you're going to be inspired to go get it after you listen to me talk about one of the lessons in this book. The book is written by an amazing guy named Gus Lee. I was lucky enough to work with Gus for about a year. He was a mentor and coach of mine, so I had hired him to be a coach. He was introduced to me through a mutual friend. Incredible guy. Get this, Gus Lee, the author, was at one time the chair of character development at West Point. I'll say that again. He was the chair of character development at West Point. So the dude is a big deal. The dude knows his stuff. The guy is all about helping people to develop their character skills. So his book, Courage, ties right in with that. The book, Courage, has an image of a spine on the cover. Okay, so on the cover of his book, Courage, there's an image of a spine, and the subtitle says, the backbone of leadership. So he says, courage is the backbone of leadership. So again, I'm just going to tell you about one of the lessons in this book. First, just to kind of give you a sense of Gus and what he's like. And first, he's the coolest, nicest guy you'd ever meet. Just one thing I remember about Gus is his wonderful smile. He has this just terrific smile. He's a super engaging person. And also, Gus Lee, he's the kind of guy that's going to tell it to you straight, all right? He's not going to beat around the bush. He's not going to hem and haw. He's going to be very pointed with you when it's time to be pointed with you. I'll give you a couple examples of that. So one thing he said to me once, he said, hey, Eric, drop your pose. You're only fooling those who don't care about you. All right, so how about that? Drop your pose. You're only fooling people who don't care about you. And I talked about this on another podcast, how sometimes we pose and we try to project this image. And I am certainly prone to do that. And he gave me that line once, and that was like, you know, I'd smack upside the head. That was a good lesson that he shared with me. Another thing that he said as it relates to this book, Courage, and what we're going to talk about, he says that conflict avoidance is the bubonic plague of our time. How about that? Conflict avoidance is the bubonic plague of our time. And so back in the day, I'm forgetting whatever century it was, you know, the bubonic plague was a big deal. It was wiping people out. And so what he says now is that people's need to avoid conflict, that's just like the bubonic plague. So whether it comes to, you know, a business or really any kind of an organization or a family or a relationship, it's the fact that so many of us are avoiding conflict that becomes like a plague. And you know what? I agree. And you know what? I admit is that oftentimes I can be part of that plague. You know, I'm certainly one that doesn't really rush into conflict. I don't get really jazzed up and excited and looking forward to having some conflict. I would rather not. And I know I'm not alone in that. And but I'm certainly one that could use some help and need some coaching with that. And that's part of the reason I chose to engage with Gus. So again, the book is Courage. I'm going to give you one of the big lessons I got from this book and one big thing I got from Gus. You're going to find that not only can you use this in business, you can absolutely use this in your family. You can use this in any relationship that you have, any organization, whether organization is a business organization, charitable, or think of your family like an organization. This will apply all across the board. And the lesson that he taught me is this thing called the three tiers of leadership. So what Gus says, there are three tiers of leadership, creatively called, and I don't mean to give Gus a hard time, creatively called tier one, tier two, tier three, and just called that so they're easy to keep track of, right? So when you think about any organization, there are three tiers of leadership, tier one, tier two, tier three, and you're going to find that tier one is the worst all the way up to tier three is the best. And I often, when I teach this, I draw a grid for people to really get this, but because it's so simple and straightforward, you can imagine this grid in your head as we go along, okay? So in a tier one organization, here's what's going on. And so the first thing that you look at when you are considering which tier an organization or a family may be living in, when you're considering which tier they may have achieved, the first thing you're looking at is what the leader does under pressure. All right, so when the leader is put under pressure, what is it that they do? And I'll ask you a question, how often are leaders put under pressure? You know, only all the time, right? Only all the time. It's every day, it's every hour. The leader is put under some kind of pressure. What kind of pressure? Well, gosh, you name it. Peer pressure, financial pressure, keeping people happy pressure, competition pressure. How about investor pressure or pressure of their own expectations, their own goals that they set? You know, they're very self-driven, self-motivated people. They have a certain dream for what they want to achieve. And if they're not achieving that, they're going to put their own pressure on themselves. Pressure of the people who are inside of the organization to demand a whole lot from the leader, expect a whole lot from the leader. Those are all examples of just some of the pressures that a leader is put under. And so again, this starts with, when it comes down to which tier are you in, it starts with what does the leader do when put under pressure? In tier one, what a leader does is they act solely for themselves. All right, so when that leader's put under pressure, their first thought, their first reaction, their first response is gonna be, all right, what am I gonna do to take care of myself? I'm feeling pressure in this situation. What is it that I can do to get the pressure off of me quickly? All right, like right away, like right now. I don't care of the outcome. I don't care of the consequence. All I care about is I want to get the pressure off of me. That's what's going on in tier one. Again, that's the lowest form of leadership, is when the leader is acting selfishly, when they're all about them. So if they're saying, geez, I just want to get this pressure off of me. I want to make sure that I look good. I want to come out of this smelling like a rose. I want to make sure that I end up in a great position because of this. I want to make sure that I don't take any heat for this. I want to make sure that I don't end up with egg on my face. Despite any consequence, despite how other people may be hurt by this or suffer from this or be impacted by this, I don't care about that. I only care about me. So in tier one, again, the leader, when under pressure, first response, what's in it for me? What am I going to do about me? How am I going to take care of me? Can you think of organizations, can you think of situations that you may have been in your life when that's going on? That stinks, right? I mean, that is no fun at all. That is a real drag, as some people would say. That's a really terrible place to be in. Tier two, what's going on? And it, by the way, we're going to come back and talk a little bit more about tier one. Tier two, what's going on is when the leader is put under pressure, they don't so much think about themselves. What they think about are the results, and especially what they think about are short-term results. So again, leader under pressure, what's their response? How do they respond under pressure? What are they thinking about under pressure? What a tier two leader does is think about, hey, you know what? No matter what, we got to get some results around here. So it's, all right, guys, I know we're dealing with all these hardships, and I know all these things are going on, but I don't really care about that. We have to ignore that. All I care about is that we just got to hit our numbers, all right? We got to get some results. So when I think about tier two, when I was taught about tier two leadership, and when I think about this, I always tend to think about publicly traded companies. And I've worked for publicly traded companies before. And what happens in a publicly traded company is it becomes so much about the quarterly earnings. In the quarterly earnings in a public company are everything. You just are so, there's so much motivation inside the organization to hit those numbers. Guys, we got to hit these numbers no matter what. And in your head or even out loud, you're thinking, yeah, but what's this going to do to us a year from now? Or, you know, this may be a good decision for the really short term, but this is really going to hurt us even 6 months from now, certainly a year from now, certainly 2 years from now. This is going to be super bad then. This may, you know, prop us up quickly right now, but this ain't going to turn out well. But the leader doesn't care about that because all they care about is getting those short-term results. And in a public company, so often that's driven by their bonuses, right? So to hit that quarterly numbers and the quarterly earnings numbers, so often what that leads to for the leader is a big, nice, fat quarterly bonus. So there's even financial incentive built in to think short-term. So that's another way to say a tier two leader, it's another way to talk about a tier two leader is that they're really, really into short-term thinking, never long-term, never worried about the outcome and the consequence of their short-term thinking. They're only thinking about the numbers. Guys, we got to hit our results. Have you ever been in those situations? I have, like I mentioned before, I've worked for a couple publicly traded companies. Boy, that when that pressure comes in to quote, hit our numbers, that is so uninspiring. It can be super stressful. It's just, it's no good at all. And maybe you've been in those situations too, where the leader's just cracking the whip on, all right, let's go, let's go, let's go, let's hit those numbers. So that's what's going on in tier two. So then it leads to tier three, which is the highest form. Again, there are only three tiers that Gus Lee talks about. Tier one, two, and three. Tier three, what's going on when the leader is put under pressure, and this is the highest form of leadership, what's going on is the leader simply, and this is a beautiful thing I'm about to tell you, the leader simply does what is right. When the leader's under pressure, all they do is focus on what is the right thing to do. In this situation, regardless of how it will make me look, regardless of what it will do to our short-term numbers, regardless of that, what is the right thing to do in this situation? And man, that's a cool thing. When you can get there, and as we all know, as I know personally, it's super hard to get there. And when you can get there, it is a beautiful thing. I have been around just a couple tier three leaders in my day, and they are just, they're so amazing to work for. They're so amazing to be around. They're so inspiring to engage with. And you know the people I'm talking about. You may have had, hopefully, at least just a couple. There aren't many around. You may have had a couple in your life, and isn't it just the best thing to be around those people? Don't they just lift you up and pick you up? Don't you feel so safe around them and so inspired by them, and you feel ready to just take on the world? And you feel that way because you know no matter what, that leader is going to act for what's right. They're going to do the right thing. So you're not freaked out about them only looking out for themselves. You're not freaked out about them only cracking the whip and looking for the short-term result. What you know no matter what is that that leader is going to do the right thing. So then, again, think about this as a grid. So the thing in the far left column would just say either tier one, two, or three. In the middle column would say, what does the leader do under pressure? Under pressure in tier one, they act selfishly. In tier two, they act for results. Tier three, they act for what's right. That would be the middle column. Now, the right column is what is the culture? So the top of the right column would say, what's the culture of the organization? What's the culture of the office? What's the culture of the company? Even what's the culture of the family? What's the culture in each one of those tiers? Check this out. This is where it gets into becoming a really powerful lesson, right? Even more impactful. Here's the culture in tier one. So in a place, in an office, company, organization, family, in a place where the leader is only looking out for themselves, the culture that you have is a culture of fear, right? It's bottom line, ultimately, when you boil it down, it's a culture of fear. Why is it fearful? Well, it's fearful because deep down, the people inside the organization, they only know that, man, when the stuff hits the fan, the only thing that's going to happen is that leader is going to be looking out for themselves, all right? It's going to be the opposite of the captain going down with the ship. That captain's going to be the first one off of the ship. We may not even know that the ship is sinking. That captain's going to bail out. That's really, really scary to watch a leader only look out for themselves, not look out for their people. That's not a good place to be in, not fun. And not only is it not fun, it can be super scary. So if you're sensing fear inside an organization, you know, if people are kind of walking on eggshells all the time, if they're kind of freaked out, it's only because there's the leadership going on is one where the person's only looking out for themselves. So that's tier one, all right? So that's a good lesson. In tier two, what's the culture? So if it's a culture of fear in tier one, what's the culture in tier two? The culture in tier two is a culture of stress, right? Does that make sense? You guys with me on that one? It's a culture of stress. So when you have a leader that's only there just cracking the whip, come on, guys, let's go, let's go. We got to hit our numbers. And in your head, you're thinking, wait, time out. This is really going to be bad a couple years from now or 6 months from now. I don't like this. And the leader is just saying, come on, come on, let's go, let's go. Let's hit those numbers. We got the quarter end coming up. That is really, really stressful. So if the focus is solely on results and quote, hitting the numbers, that's no fun because it's stressful. That's a super, super stressful place to be. Then we arrive at tier three, the highest form of leadership. You have a place where no matter what, the leader is going to act for what's right. They are going to do the right thing, regardless of how it will make them look, regardless of how it will make them feel, regardless of how it may impact short-term numbers. No matter what, they're going to do the right thing. And the culture in a tier three place is a culture of courage. And so that's how this all circles back to the title of the book. It's a culture of courage. It's a courageous organization where people can act confidently. They can move forward knowing that no matter what, that leader is going to have their back. No matter what, that leader is going to be looking out for them first. No matter what, that leader is always thinking about the long term and how it's going to impact other people. And the leader wants the organization to thrive for the long term. That is a culture of courage. And I hope, no matter what, I hope that you have been in one of those places. I hope even more that you're in one of those places right now. I have just a couple times in my life, I've been inside of those places, and it is an amazing thing. It's an amazing place to be, and the vibe in the place is so incredible, and you just so look forward to going into those organizations every day and being around those kind of people and being in that kind of environment that's so inspiring and so just full of courage. And I'll end this with the coolest lesson tied to this that I'd heard Gus talk about. The question is, how do you know? How do you know when you're in a tier three organization? So pretend you're out visiting different companies. You're writing a research paper on organization's culture, and you go, you're just bopping around from company to company, place to place, and you're doing this research on culture. So how do you know when you found a place that has tier three? And what Gus says, you can tell by looking into the eyes of the people who are there. And what he says is, if the eyes are shining, then you know you found a tier three place. So the evidence of tier three is shining eyes. And I just love that. I had to share that with you. That's one of the coolest things I've ever learned in my life, that the shining eyes lesson. Are the eyes shining? So for me, what I'll tell you in my role as a leader of my company, you know, I work with my company, I work with lots of people. What I'm looking for so often, I'm looking in their eyes, and I'm looking to see if the eyes are shining. And if the lights are out in someone's eyes, then I know that we ain't at tier three, all right? There's something else going on. It could be tier one behavior by me, where I'm only just looking out for myself. I'm unwilling to take on a hard thing because of the discomfort it may cause me. I may be only focused on the numbers. I may be too much cracking the whip. That's causing the lights to go out. If the eyes are not shining, that's on me to go do something about it. And you can probably think of that, think of it in your own company, in your own organization, even in your own family. You know, are the lights on or are the lights out? And when you can get the lights on with people, if you can get the eyes shining, you know you've achieved that tier three place that we strive for. And again, that is an amazing, that is a beautiful thing. So what's the lesson? Well, one lesson is we're all leaders. We're all leaders, regardless of your title, like regardless of whatever's on your business card, we're all leaders. So it's not only on other people. We don't have to wait around for someone else to become a tier three person. We can take that on ourselves. We can own a lot of this responsibility ourselves. So what we want to do is not be selfish, right? Obviously, we don't want to be selfish. We don't want to be only looking out for ourselves. So watch yourself under pressure. Am I only looking out for myself and what's going to be good for me and how I'm going to look good and how I'm going to come out of this smelling like a rose and how I'm going to keep myself comfortable? Am I only focused on just getting some short-term results? Oh my gosh, I just got to get some short-term results. I don't really care about the long-term. Just want to get some short-term results going here. Are you doing that? Or are you acting for what is right, regardless of how it may make you look, how it may make you feel? Are you acting for what's right? Are you acting for what's right, regardless of how it may impact the short term? Are you acting for what's right? We all can work to be in that tier three kind of place. All right, that's the lesson from the one and only Gus Lee from his book, Courage. Please, please, please go check out the book. It is just amazing. Spread the word about how good the book is so that we can get some more book sales for Gus. That'd be cool. And as always, guys, as always, I appreciate you tuning in and engaging with the Leading Edge podcast. If you want more of things just like this, get signed up for a membership. Join theleadingedge.com. Get inside the inner circle where you can get access to way more resources, all kinds of things that are really going to help you out in your business. In the meantime, enjoy life on the leading edge. Thank you.